For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you.
Good morning, church. Wonderful to see you all here. It's great to be together. It's great for me to stand here and worship with you this morning. So, yeah, it's difficult with the masks on, but God is good, and He's going to speak to our hearts this morning. Let's stand together and worship our mighty God. Let's bring Him honor through our voices. free. Thank you that we are your chosen people. Oh, Lord, we just welcome you in this place. Yes, Lord.
Who am I that the highest would welcome? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love.
For me, not against me. I am who you say.
Jesus now and ever is my
shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know.
Holy God, you deserve all the honor, all the praise, all the glory. We give our hearts to you this morning. Lord, as your word's broken this morning, I just pray that we will open our spiritual eyes and that you will open it so we may see what you have to say to us, that we may hear your word as it's preached to us, God's truth penetrating through skin and bone. We honor you this morning, Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. Amen. Amen.
Thank you so much to Louisa and the team for leading us today, and it's my joy to say a good morning to all of you as well. Welcome to GBC, and a special welcome to those watching us online on the live stream. We've got a brand new camera there at the back. If you turn around, you'll be on candid camera. But it's a brand new HD, high definition camera that's broadcasting this service as we are here, basically all around the world on the live stream. And so we've had people from New Zealand already comment, to the Roth family, Jenny Metcalf over there, greetings to you. In New Zealand is 8 o'clock in the evening, so they're watching in the lounge together, the Roth family, to those in the UK, those in Australia, in different parts of the world. Margie Denniker commented, she's watching as well. We miss old Margie, your place is empty. Margie, your place is waiting for you. Brenda Swift in Stillby, greetings to you. And those are commenting on the Facebook feed now as we are yet together. So it's one big family scattered around the world, but through technology we connected today, which is an absolute joy. Well, friends, it's also a joy to be able to share with you that I managed to put a little book together over the lockdown period. It's called Divine Design. And really what I wanted to do was to go back to a preaching series I shared last year from the book of Exodus called The Top Ten. And as the cover shows you, there's a man there with a rucksack on his back. So you can imagine he's on a journey, as all of us are on. And he gets to a fork in the road. He's got a decision to make. He can go left and do things God's way, according to divine design. Or he can choose to go right and live life according to his own design. And of course, each choice has consequences. And so I would really encourage you to get yourself a copy, maybe get one for a friend or a family member or a work colleague that are available this morning up front here. I said that you can help yourself. And it really is based on an honesty system. I know you don't look like very honest people with your masks on today, a bunch of bandits, but I really do believe we're honest people. But listen, and I really do mean this from the bottom of my heart. If you're here today and you say, I can't afford 100 rand, it's just too much for me, you're absolutely, incredibly welcome to take one for free and may it be a blessing to you. To those who are watching online and you're wondering how you can get a book, just watch the Facebook page this week and the website, and I'll share with you details how you can order copies and we can ship them around the country. Unfortunately, New Zealand, you'll have to wait a little bit for yours to arrive. All right, just to remind you, we are in the book of Acts. We're in the middle of a series called A Spirit-Empowered People. And really what we're doing is we're going back to our roots as a church. We're retracing our steps. We're going back 2,000 years to the city of Jerusalem where the church was launched, where it began all those years ago. Last week was a real highlight as we looked at the fact that Jesus Christ, the head of the church, poured out his Holy Spirit upon men and women on the day of Pentecost, empowering and equipping us to get out there into the real world, advance the kingdom of God, and bring glory to the name of Jesus on a global scale. And so our key verse over the last 3 weeks has been Acts 1 verse 8, where Jesus said, but you shall receive dunamos, big power, dynamite power, Holy Spirit power, to enable you to be witnesses for Jesus in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So clearly we understand that the church is way more than a social club. The church is a group of Holy Spirit-filled men and women on a kingdom-advancing, Jesus-glorifying global mission. Does that sound great? That's who we are. And those watching online, that's who you are. A group of Holy Spirit-filled men and women on a kingdom-advancing, Jesus-glorifying global mission. That is who we are. As a church, we exist to declare the glory of God, to declare the goodness of God, to declare the manifold wisdom of God. Listen to this, not just to the natural world, but also to the principalities and powers in heavenly places. Ephesians 3 verse 10, Paul outlines the purpose of the church. He says his intent was that now through the church, through men and women like you who love and follow Jesus, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms. Can you see that being part of the church of Jesus Christ is no small thing? So today we're going to get practical and we are going to look at some of the key pillars of the early church and then see how we can apply them to our local context here in Ganubi and wherever you may be watching from around the world. So let's turn in our Bibles to Acts chapter 2 and read from verse 41 to 47. Acts chapter 2, verse 41 to 47. So just to give you some context, the Holy Spirit has been poured out upon the early church. Peter now stands up and preaches a riveting, powerful sermon. And this is what happens from verse 41 onwards. Then those who gladly received his word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. Can you imagine 3,000 people coming to Jesus in one day in Gnubi? It's happened before, it can happen again. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in prayers. Then fear came upon every soul, and many signs and wonders were done through the apostles. Now all who believed were together and had all things in common. They sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as anyone had need. So continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who are being saved. Father, we want to take a moment now this morning to thank you so much for your precious word. Lord, thank you that week after week we get the privilege of opening up this God-inspired book. A book that has stood the test of time. A book that has changed lives over the course of generations. And Father, I pray today that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would cause us to see what we need to see today, to hear what we need to hear, and then, Lord, give us hearts of obedience that will take this word and put it into practice. Father, I pray for your blessing upon every single person present here today, for all those watching around the world on the live stream. Lord, every person has got unique needs. Every person is facing unique challenges. But Father, thank you for your grace that is sufficient. Thank you that your power is made perfect in our weakness. And so, Father, I pray for hope to rise in our hearts. I pray for encouragement and for the ability to lift up our eyes above the challenges around us and to fix our gaze on Jesus Christ, the author and the finisher of our faith. Lord, may we declare to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms, that our God reigns. Our God reigns. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, friends, the first thing we need to clarify right up front as we launch the sermon today is that the New Testament never uses the word church, or in the original language, ecclesia, to refer to a building or to a place. The word church in the New Testament always, 100% of the time, refers to people, real, living human beings. The church either refers to the global church, in other words, the total number of those around the world who love and follow Jesus, or it refers to a local church, a localized group of Christ followers who meet together like we are doing this morning in Gnubi. Let me give you a couple of scriptures. Ephesians 1 verse 22, Paul describes the church in this way. He says, "And God put all things under his feet," referring to Jesus, "and appointed Jesus to be head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all." So clearly here, Paul is referring to the global church. All those who love and follow Jesus, no matter where in the world they happen to find themselves. Jesus Christ today is the head of the global universal church. But what about the context of local churches? Well, 1 Corinthians 16 verse 19 puts it this way. Paul writes, "The churches, plural, in the province of Asia, send you greetings. Aquila and Priscilla greet you warmly in the Lord. And so does the church that meets in their home." So here Paul is writing to a local church meeting in the city of Corinth. He refers to other local churches in the province of Asia who send them greetings, as well as a much smaller church They meet in the home of two ladies. So yeah, GBC, clearly we've got a combination. We have larger groups that meet together on a Sunday like we're doing today. We also have smaller groups that meet together in people's homes during the course of the week. And friends, we see this pattern throughout the New Testament. Larger and smaller groups of Christ followers meeting together on a regular basis. Sometimes thousands of them at a time, like in verse 41, 3,000 added to the church. If you've been to Turkey, you'll have been to those large amphitheaters, like in Ephesus. Cindy, you'll remember that, where we sang Amazing Grace together. A huge amphitheater seating thousands and thousands of people where the Apostle Paul would preach. So large groups, but also smaller groups meeting together in different homes. But here comes the important thing. Be the church big or be the church small, there are certain key characteristics that make a church a church. And so let's have a look at a few of them today. Well, number one, we can see that these groups of Christ followers in the book of Acts, they met together on a regular basis. We know that from verse 42 and verse 46. In verse 42, we read that they devoted themselves. They continued steadfastly. There was a sense of dedication and devotion to the church and to the things of God. Verse 46, and day by day, attending the temple together, breaking bread in their homes, they ate together with glad and sincere hearts. Now, a couple of years ago, and those of you who are watching on the live stream may not remember this, but a couple of years ago, I coined the phrase in this church that if you show up, you're going to grow up. Some of you remember it. And what I was trying to get you to understand by that point was exactly what Acts describes. If you can get into the habit, and there's a key word, the habit of attending church on a regular basis, putting yourself in a position to hear from God's word and to meet with other believers, the chances are you're going to grow and develop in your faith because that is God's divine design. That is God's blueprint. And over the years, as your pastor, I've actually experienced the joy of seeing so many of you develop and grow and mature in your faith. You're not the same men and women you were 5 years ago. You've grown and developed because you've put this principle into practice. Hebrews 10 verse 25 encourages us with these words. And let us not neglect our meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encourage one another, especially now as the day of his return is drawing near. You know, there's something about church. The more you attend church, the more you want to attend church. The less you attend church, the less you want to attend church. Develop and cultivate a good, consistent habit in your life. What about Jesus? Was synagogue attendance, church attendance important for Jesus? Well, Luke 4 verse 16 tells us this. So Jesus came to Nazareth where he had been brought up. And on the Sabbath day, he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. So if regular synagogue or church attendance was important for Jesus, the Son of God, then how much more important should it be for me as an ordinary, regular person? So pillar number one in the early church was this dedication, this steadfastness, this commitment to meeting together. Where in verse 42, it tells us that enjoy solid Bible teaching. The New King James puts their doctrine, not just things you want to hear, but things you actually need to hear, the breaking of bread and prayer. But then, of course, pillar number two would be that of worship. Worship was a key pillar in the early church. Have a look at verse 43. In describing the early church, Luke writes, everybody was filled with awe. Don't you love that word, awe? Another version says a deep sense of awe came over them all. Verse 47 speaks of them praising God. We've just done that a few moments ago. The sense of worship, of being in awe of God, was a key component of the early church. Friends, remember, never forget this. Every single human being is a worshiper. It's just the object of worship that differs from person to person. But at GBC, listen to this very carefully, we never want to lose our sense of being in awe of God. We never want to lose our reverence and respect for who God is. Through our songs and through our words, we want to acknowledge the supremacy of Jesus, the greatness of Jesus. We want to remember that we are loved by God. How does it make you feel this morning to be unconditionally loved by God? Doesn't your heart want to respond in worship to that? There is nothing you can do to make God love you more, to make God love you less. You are beloved, blood-bought, covenant, son or daughter of the Most High God. Doesn't your heart want to worship when you hear those truths? We want to remember 2,000 years ago that Jesus Christ went to the cross. He died in our place and for our sin. We want to remember that. We want to remember that the power of God raised Jesus Christ from the dead. We want to remember that Jesus Christ has given us the power of the Holy Spirit. We want to remember that today, even over COVID-19, even over the brokenness around the world, that Jesus Christ reigns over the nations as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and He is coming back to receive us to Himself. And until He comes, or until He calls your name, nothing in heaven or on earth will ever be able to separate you from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Don't you want to worship Him? May the Holy Spirit inspire the modern day church to be a generation of worshipers. Of worshipers. What else characterized the early church? Verse 45, generosity. They were generous people. Look what it says. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Can you imagine that happening today? People selling houses, people selling cars and boats to give to those like me in need. Not a bad idea. To those who got foreign currency in New Zealand, think about this man. You know, one of the fiercest critics of the early church was recorded as saying this. Their founder, obviously referring to Jesus, taught them that they should be like brothers to one another. They despised their own privacy and viewed their possessions as common property. The early church was gripped by the spirit of a God who gave Himself away. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. They inherited the DNA of a Savior, Jesus, who was the ultimate giver. The servant of servants who gave His life. Friends, we know historically, and you can do the research for yourself, we know historically that in the first 3 centuries, the Church of Jesus Christ experienced explosive growth, something the world had never seen before. From Jerusalem, the church multiplied exponentially. And the question is, why? How did it happen? Tim Keller puts it this way. Tim Keller says, the church was attractively different to the world around them. There was this radical spirit of unselfishness that had never been seen before. Oh, may the Holy Spirit awaken in us, the modern day church, a spirit of unselfishness, a spirit of generosity, to be givers, not takers, to be contributors, not consumers. Like the early church, to give of ourselves, to give of our time, to give of our energy, to give of our resources sacrificially, to advance the kingdom of God and to glorify the name of Jesus all around the world. So how are you doing so far in those areas? Consistency, worship, generosity. Well, let's finish up with one final pillar, which maybe is the glue that holds them all together. And that was that the early church was characterized by fellowship, togetherness, community. Have a look at verse 41. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship. There's that word. Verse 44. Now all who believed were together and had all things in common. Fellowship, togetherness, community. In fact, the word in the original language for fellowship is the word koinonia, which can be translated sharing, contributing, partnership, participation. The early church was all about togetherness, all about community. Friends, there's no New Testament mandate. It doesn't exist for a lone ranger Christian. It's impossible to love Jesus and neglect his bride. The two go together. The early church was characterized by devotion for Jesus and a devotion for each other. As iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. But now let me tell you that this idea of koinonia, of fellowship, togetherness, community, is becoming increasingly rare in our individualistic modern day society and in the church. And let me tell you why. One of the main reasons is, sad to say, technology. If I had my cell phone with me and hold it up, in particular cell phones, let me tell you why. Here's a quote. It's been said that the small screen, referring to the cell phone screen, is the most selfish device ever devised. Everyone now becomes the creator of their own private world, a secret world of temptation and relationships. We don't even gather around the big screen, the television anymore, as families and as friends, because each person is consumed by their own small screen. It's possible in this generation to have 1,000 Facebook friends, but to have few real life friends. And if we don't like them, we can unfriend them. We can block them, and that friendship is gone. Friends, we can create our own virtual world while having very little impact upon the real world with real people. We can stream our favorite preacher, and if we don't like what he's saying, we can just flip the channel with no accountability, no responsibility. I want to say to you this morning, dear friends, this is not God's design for the church. God's design is koinonia. It's fellowship. It's human beings, real life human beings, meeting together, sharing the mountains and the valleys together, loving one another, supporting one another, being there for one another, especially in difficult days, like we find ourselves in today. Friends, we need each other to make it for the long haul. There are those in this building today for whom this lockdown has been a tragic and traumatic experience. There are people in this building today who have lost loved ones. I've buried them. There are people today who have lost jobs, lost income. They wouldn't be here today had they been Lone Ranger Christians. They're here today because people gathered around them, real life people, and loved them and supported them and prayed for them and brought them meals. This is God's design. Not cell phone church, not technology, but real people who love Jesus and who are devoted to loving one another for the long haul. So, let's finish up by going back to the beginning. Our very reason, our purpose for existing as the church is to what? We said to declare to the world and to the heavens the goodness of God, the greatness of God, and the manifold wisdom of God. But the question is, how are we going to do it? We've got the mandate, but how are we going to do it? Well, we're going to do it by aligning our spiritual DNA individually and collectively, aligning our lives as a church, aligning our mission statement with the blueprint of God's word, divine design. Not doing church our way, not discovering our new blueprint, but going back to the book of Acts and saying, Lord, we align our lives, we align our churches with the blueprint of your word. And then, ordinary men and women, full of the Spirit of God, are going to leave these doors, are going to enter mainstream society, and in business, education, retirement centers, medicine, we are going to represent Jesus well. Through our lives and through our words, we are going to point the world to Jesus. Let your light, Matthew 5:16, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Friends, in these difficult and challenging days, may we represent the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords well in every arena of life. Let's declare to the natural world and to the spiritual world, our God reigns. Jesus Christ is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and he reigns over the nations. He is the hope of the world. Let's declare that to the world around us and to the ends of the earth. Let us pray. Just wanted to give us a moment as we come to the end of the service. To those who are watching on the live stream, you want to join in with this time of prayer as well. As your eyes are closed and you are just bringing your life before the Lord, just challenge yourself gently in these four areas. Number one, how are you doing when it comes to devotion, steadfastness, and consistency in terms of meeting with God's people? Maybe you've allowed a bad habit to creep into your life and church has become less of a priority for you. And today the Holy Spirit is gently drawing you back to say, you need others for this journey. You need to regain that spirit of steadfastness and commitment and consistency. How are you doing when it comes to worship? Have you become consumed by the negativity on social media, satellite television? Have you allowed pessimism and doubt and unbelief to grip your heart? And maybe the Holy Spirit of God is saying to you today, wherever you find yourselves, today is a day to worship. Worship a God who loves you. Worship a Savior who died for you. Because nothing can ever separate you from his love. Worship, worship. How are you doing when it comes to generosity? Are you like the early church, unselfishly giving of your time and your life and your resources to advance the kingdom of God and to glorify the name of Jesus? And how are you doing when it comes to koinonia, to fellowship, partnership, togetherness, unity, walking the road with others? Father, we bring these things before you today. We want to realign our lives. We want to realign our church with the divine design of your word, with your heavenly blueprint for church. Doing it your way, Lord. And then, Father, now as we leave this building, may you send out men and women. May you send out boys and girls full of the Holy Spirit. full of the fire of God, to go and represent you well in the different arenas of life. May we shine our lights, Lord, and bring glory to the great name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Won't you seal these words in our hearts? May nothing be lost, for we pray them in Jesus' great name. Amen. Friends, what a joy to have brought that word to you. You may want to go home and do some journaling and some thinking and some praying, and just allow the Lord to cement this word in your hearts. Don't forget, as you leave today, there are offering baskets at the back for you to give your tithes and your offerings. For those watching online, if you want to contribute, the banking details are on the website for you to give. And for those who need prayer, you just someone today who says, Mark, I need some prayer. I'm struggling. I need some encouragement. I've got a need in my life. Friends, we would love to pray for you. There's people at the back there, at the back doors. You meet them there. You take a right. It's a private place where you can pray. Don't leave this place. Have you not been prayed for? If you have a need. For those of you who want to purchase books, they're available up front and will be available over the coming weeks. But may God bless you today as you keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. Amen. Amen.